नमस्कार, वेलकम टू दिस समरी सेशन ऑफ द थर्ड अध्याय ऑफ श्रीमद् भगवद गीता, दैट इज द कर्म योग। वी स्टार्ट विद द ग्रैटिट्यूड टुवर्ड्स द लॉर्ड हूज ग्रेस दिस इज पॉसिबल, एंड वी प्रे टू द गुरु परंपरा, द लीनिएज टू विच दिस नॉलेज हैज बीन प्रोटेक्टेड एंड ट्रांसफर्ड फ्रॉम जनरेशंस टू जनरेशंस, एंड आई पे माय रिस्पेक्ट्स टू आवर गुरुजी Pujya Guruma, with whose grace I am able to learn these scriptures and share with you my understanding. Let us start with a prayer. Om Sahana Bhavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karvavahai, Tejasvinavaditamastu, Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So before we start with the third adhyaya, the Karma Yoga, let us see what recapitulate what was said in the second adhyaya by Bhagavan Shri Krishna. In the second adhyaya, for the first 10 shlokas, it was Krishna Arjuna Samvada, where Arjuna was in the grief, was shoka grasta. And then finally he was very confused and he accepts the shishyatva of Shri Krishna. In the 7th shloka, shishyastyeham shadimam tvam prapannam. From the 11th shloka, Shri Krishna starts his message not only to Arjuna but the entire mankind through Arjuna, which is the crux of the summary of the Upanishada, the sar of the Upanishada, the message of oneness, Atma, Anatma, and entire aikya between Jiva, Brahma, everything is just one. And that Jnana Utesh was shared. After that, he told Arjuna that even if you don't understand this at this moment, that's okay. Do your duty, your sadharma, kartavya, Utesha. And then he started with the change of the topic, started with Karma Yoga, said about the Karma Yoga Siddhanta, and then talked about the Sthita Pragna Mahapurusha Lakshana, from the 54th to the 71st shloka, and then finally in the 72nd shloka, the final shloka, talked about the ultimate goal of the human life, Brahmisthiti Prapta, and how we can attain liberation, salvation, moksha from this Brahmisthiti. So with this, the second adhyaya completed, and the third adhyaya, which is the more detailed description of the attitudes of Karma Yoga, starts. The Karma Yoga is the first step in the spiritual journey for Antakarana Shuddhi. It is said that karma gati is quite gahan, it's very deep, meaning that the meaning of karma itself in the second adhyaya, Shri Krishna says that karma, akarma, vikarma, all these is quite difficult to understand. It's very difficult. That's why we need a guru, an enlightened guru, to teach us about what is Karma Yoga. And with this Guru Parampara, this knowledge has been protected, passed on, because karma is done by everyone. But what is Karma Yoga? Karma Yoga is done only by very few people. And this is the main tool for upliftment, because it causes Antakarana Shuddhi, it dissolves all our Raga Dvesha. And normally the karma which causes bondage, with Karma Yoga we can lead to freedom. So the same karma has to be done with a different attitude, so that from bondage it can give us the freedom and can make us independent of anything else. So this Karma Yoga, as we have seen so far, it is a skill in action, but it is not a skill, outwardly skill. It's an inner attitude which needs to be changed, not just towards our karma, our actions, but even towards our karma phala. The attitudes of Karma Yoga that we have seen so far, dharma karma, kartavya karma, the duty as a offering to the Lord, as Ishwara Arpana Buddhi, Ishwara Samarpana, no compromise with our life principles, acceptance of the karma phala with a Svikar Buddhi as a Prasada Buddhi, and more the acceptance of karma phala, more we become peaceful. That is the phala of this Karma Yoga. And we have to make use of our karma to liberate from our karma. So we have to focus on our actions. We have to do our best. But karma phala, we don't have to focus on that. We have to be prepared for anything, whatever the result, because there may be several reasons why karma phala can be different, that is beyond my control, My control is only in the karma which I do the way I do it. So I need to focus on my karma. The benefits of karma yoga are that our mindset, our personality will become more abundant from a scarcity, because we'll be starting to think about more people rather than just thinking about our own self. We'll work with happiness and we'll work out of happiness to share the joy. It essentially maintains a rhythm and balance of our life. It gives a lot of satisfaction of our life and a real peace of our mind, real peace that we can get with karma yoga. So this can be experienced by a spiritual aspirant. So the first shloka of the karma yoga starts with Arjuna's question. Jayasi chit karmanaste mata buddhir janardana tat kim karmani ghore maam niyojayasi keshava. And Arjuna's question is in the relation between the karma and the jnana, because in the second adhyaya Lord talked about karma yoga as well as talked about the jnana, and finally ended with the sita pragna, the brahmi sthiti, the paripurna avastha, the jnani mahapurush. And that's why it was in the mind of the Arjuna, this was a question whether karma is better or jnana is better. What should I do? Whether should I do karma and fight this war, or should I go away and do my jnana sadhana and become a sannyasi and go for jnana? So he asks, if according to you knowledge is superior to actions, O Lord Keshava, why do you push me into this grievous battle? He says, and this shows Arjuna's simplicity. It also shows that in our Shastras, asking questions is always encouraged, and it is on us, the sadhakas, the seekers, to ask questions with the inquisitiveness and to our Guru, what is better, what should we do, and that is what always it is in question and answer form. And he says, Vyamishreneva bhakyena buddhim mohayasiva me tadekam vadanishchitya yena shreyoham apnuyam. So Arjuna asked that, he says he is confused with all the mixed things that Lord Krishna says. He says, with the conflicting words, it has deluded my mind. It has caused a lot of moha in my mind, delusion in my mind. So tell me one clear thing that I need to do with which I will be able to attain the supreme state. So he wants Shreya. Arjuna wants Shreya Kalyan. He wants to be better. He wants to be uplifted. He wants the Shreya Marg. And that is also an important aspect of a spiritual aspirant. He must want his upliftment. Only then Lord will be there to help him and to progress on this path, to show him the right way. That is what Arjuna is doing here. To which Lord answers, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Lokesmin Vividha Nishtha Pura Prokta Mayanaga Jnana Yogena Sankhyanam Karma Yogena Yoginam. So Lord does not give him a single answer. Arjuna asks that tell me one thing that I need to do, karma or jnana. And here Bhagavan Shri Krishna tells him that there are two paths that are already told by me ages before, maybe in ancient times. For knowledge seeking yogis, jnana yogis, it is a jnana yoga, the path of knowledge. And for the karma yogena yoginam, for the action oriented people, it is the path of action, the karma yoga. So he shows two nishchas or two different paths of determined approaches in life. For all of us who are in karma, he shows us that there could be karma yoga nishtha, there could be jnana yoga nishtha. But for most of us, karma yoga is much, much better, because we are all action oriented people. Only people who have been shuddhi, purification of the mind, those whose desires have gone down, they don't want to achieve too much from this world, outward world, they are the people who have developed, vairagya, they have already have tyaga bhavana. So they are the people who can go for karma tyaga and they can go for jnana yoga nishtha, they can become a sannyasi. But for most of the people, karma yoga is what is a much preferred marg according to Lord Krishna. So we need to understand how we can convert our karmas into karma yoga. But finally, even for a karma yogi and for a jnana yogi, the final destination is to have the jnana nishtha or the atma jnana. And for this, we need to do the Jnana Sadhana, which involves or requires Shravana, Manana and Nididhyasana. So this is common between Karma Yogi as well as Jnana Yogi. For both it is the same. Even Jnani, a person who takes Sannyasa, also does that to prepare himself and completely focus his attention for this Jnana Sadhana. Same for Karma Yoga person who is in the Pravritti, who is in the householder, also must go into the Jnana Sadhana after he does his Karma Yoga. So these two determined lifestyle approaches are dependent on the Adhikaritva, our inclination, our candidature, whether the Karma Yoga is a preference or Jnana Yoga. So it is said that these two lifestyle preferences are Gruhastha and the Sannyasa Jeevan. Grihastha Jeevan is the Pravritti Marga, where one is a householder, one lives in the household, has a family, but still can pursue the spiritual path and can ultimately obtain the final destination, the final goal of attainment of the Lordship, being one with the God. Even in the Sannyasa Marg, the Nivritti Marg also, one can devote its time for this Jnana Sadhana and can develop the oneness and obtain the final goal of his life. So both the Marg are conducive to the spiritual upliftment. In our ancient lineage, one need not be a sannyasi to go into spiritual aspect. Even most of the Mahabharata and most of the Bhagavatam Kathas, most of them, the spiritual yogis have been householders and Pravritti Margiya people. So this Karma Yoga, that's why it assumes a lot of importance in our Shastra. So Karmi, what is the difference between Karmi as a worker and the Karma Yogi, who is a person who does Karma Yoga according to what Shri Krishna says? The main difference is that the Karmi does Sakama Karma. He does action with his only for fulfillment of his desires, and that's why this is more like a self-centered or selfish karma, and he gets the Sansara Phala, means he gets the worldly results. Whatever name, fame, money and whatever money can buy, all the worldly achievements that he gets are all worldly pleasures. Whereas a Karma Yogi does Nishkam Karma. He does selfless action more for people around him, and he does it with the Ishwararpana Bhav. So he has a role of God even in his life at every step. So he makes karma along with his bhakti. Ishwararpana Bhav itself means there is bhakti, there is surrender, there is devotion. So with this attitude, when he starts doing karma, so karma plus bhakti makes it a Karma Yoga. And this leads to Antakarana Shuddhi, that is purification of the mind, which is most essential part of the sadhana, where all the raga, dvesha, all the kama, krodha, moha, mada, matsarya, all these the asuri sampatti, they have to be removed from our mind to make it more shuddha, sapeksha, shuddhi, and then we can undergo the jnana sadhana to achieve the jnana. So jnana can only come when the patra or the vessel is more shuddha, it is more clear. Similarly, one can only see if the glasses are clean. If the glasses are dirty, we cannot have the vision. So similarly, antakarana, the inner mind, also has to be clean. Inner glasses have to be clean before we can obtain this atma jnana, which can lead to mukti or moksha or liberation. Nakarmana manarambha nishkarmyam purushoshnute nacha sanyasana deva siddhim samadhigacchati. So in this shloka, Lord Krishna says no to renunciation of action. In all of our scriptures, never that agna or order of renunciating from the karmas is given. Karmas is always given a very great importance in our shastras. And he says, by doing karma tyaga, one cannot achieve moksha. So it's better not to become lazy, but to get into karma. From akarma, we have to get into karma. So that is the first thing. And the second thing that Lord Krishna says here is, nacha sanyasanat eva siddhim samadhi gacchati, means by renouncing the world, by taking sannyasa, also just by taking sannyasa without doing any jnana sadhana, one cannot achieve the liberation or the final goal of life. So both these things, karma tyaga and sannyasa or sansara tyaga, both are no. It is not at all advisable for people. It is said like it is like a ripened fruit. The fruit, when it becomes ripe, it will fall off by itself. It need not be plucked before it becomes ripened. So karma also similarly, whenever it becomes mature, it will just fall off and then the person becomes by his own knowledge, his karma will fall off. So karma tyaga or karma sannyasa is not just a means for liberation. That's what he says. Nahi kaschit kshanam api jatu tishtatya karma kruta karyate yavashah karma sarva prakruti jair gunaihi. So here Lord Krishna says that even for a moment people cannot live without karma. So we all are always, you know, engrossed in our karma, and this is because the three gunas of the prakruti, you know, the sattva, rajas and the tamas, always forces us to perform action. We are all into action because of these. And this, in the base of this, what works is our raga dvesha. And these are the main initiators for our action. Rag leads us to attracting or, you know, giving us a pleasure, things which give us pleasure. Dvesh means repulsion. For things which give us pain, we go for repulsion. So these raga dvesha have to be nullified, and karma yoga is one of the most important means for neutralizing or nullifying these raga dvesha. Karmendriyani sayamya ya aste manasasmaran indriyathan vimudhatma mithyachara sa uchyate. So here Lord Krishna says that somebody who renounces physical action and then he just sits in meditation or silence or goes into sannyasa and then he keeps thinking about all the worldly objects in his mind, that person is a hypocrite. This is not the true person that Lord Krishna likes, this kind of person. One who controls his senses of organ, karmendriya, and then manasa smaran indriyarthan. So he is a big fool and he is a hypocrite. But what Shri Krishna likes is what he says in the 7th shloka. And this is the person who is a karma yogi, a true karma yogi. That is what Lord Krishna wants us to become. Yastvindriyani manasa niyam yarabate chuna karmendriyai karma yogam asakta sa vishishyate. So this person is a vishishta person, vishishyate. He praises that there are two things that he talks about here. One who performs, controls his sense organs with his mind, indriya sanyam, which is most important and is always given a lot of importance to indriya sanyam. And second is he performs the action karma yoga without attachment, asakta. Vishishyata. This person is a vishesh person or vishishyate who does indriya sanyam and who performs karma yoga with anasakti or without asakti, without attachment. So that is the person who Lord Krishna likes. So he says, and then he focuses a lot on indriya sanyam, the sense control, which is a very important part of our spiritual sadhana or spiritual path. So basically, Vishaya, Indriya, Mana, Buddhi and Atma. If you see this, the Mana is in the center and this is the main thing that we need to control. Because Indriya are naturally Bahirmukha. They want to go out. That is what their Swabhava is. And they are very chanchala, very, very active. We must have experienced that even if we are closing our eyes for some time for meditation, there is a small sound on something. We hear something or, you know, there is something. Then immediately our eyes will open up because the indriya will get activated with any object. So this vishaya, they, you know, try to take the indriya towards them, attract indriya towards them, harate. So indriya goes there, and sometimes if mana is not composed, then it will also be taken away along with the indriya. But if the buddhi is more powerful on the other side, then it will control the mana, and the mana will not go and rush out with the indriya into the vishaya. So here that is called samharate, and that is the indriya sanyama, that is called dama, and that is one of the parts of the sadhan chatushtaya sampatti, shama adi shat sampatti, where shama is the mana sanyama and dama is the indriya sanyama. So these two are very, very important for any aspirant. And the raga and dvesha are the root cause of all problems. Raga essentially is a sukha vritti, that this thing, this person, this situation should always remain with me. So this kind of a kamana, and when it remains with me, I believe that it again also should remain with me, again should come with me, it should stay with me, and that is called the moha. Whereas dvesha is the dukha vritti, where we have a repulsion for that particular thing. It should not be with me because I don't like it. This is something that I hate, I don't like, and that's why it should go away from me. And if it comes close to me, then I am, you know, become angry on that person or that situation or with myself if that situation arises. And if it is suppressed for a long period of time, it can turn even violence. So raga dvesha, they remain in the indriya, mana, buddhi. That is what will come in this the third adhyaya in a very dormant state, and they get activated by some nimitta, and the indriya and the senses activate them, and they create a kind of an impression or a sanskara or a chap on the mind, and this constantly, you know, drives us into our human behavior. And Jnani's man is like a mirror, there are no impressions, and that's why they work without these raga dvesha. They have already neutralized these raga dvesha, and that's why their behavior is very sahaj, very saral. It's not, through the raga dvesha they are not activated. So indriya sanyama is a very important part of sadhana. The main image of the Sri Bhagavad Gita, if you see this chariot image, is also quite representative of what the message of the Gita ji is. And this is described as the allegory that is given with this chariot is that the horses are like our indriya. They are very chanchala, they want to run around, they are like untamed horses. But the lagam, that the strings, is the mana. And mana is, or the lagam is in the hands of the buddhi, the sarathi. And here the sarathi is none other than Lord Krishna. So buddhi, with the sarathi, this, the horses have to be tamed. It is through the lagam, the man, and that is how we have to develop from raga and dvesha vritti. We have to develop what is called as the upeksha vritti, and gradually we have to go towards samatva bhavana. So samatva is the raga, dvesha have been neutralized, nirdhando, all the dvandva that is there in this world, the dualities, we have to rise above this and develop a samatva bhavana by sahanshilta. These are all the things that are important on this sadhana. And the true success in life is to develop this mana ke upar vijaya, means the victory over our mind, over our indriya. That is the real victory or the true success of life. In the second session of the Karma Yoga, we talked about the four attitudes as have been shown by Sri Krishna of doing Karma Yoga: the attitude of duty, the attitude of death, runa ada, attitude of yagna, yagna buddhi, prasada buddhi or the karma phala, and dharma buddhi, or described the srushti chakra. So in the 8th shloka it says, niyatam kuru karmatvam karmachayo ya karmanah sharira yatra pichate na prasiddhyed karmanah. So this is the attitude of duty, niyatam kuru karmatam, whatever is your prescribed duty, you do it in the best possible way. And the second thing he says is, karma dhyayo jayo yah akarmanah, means action is better than inaction. So always the message is that we should not remain lazy, we should always be in our duty, our actions, and we should do our best. So laziness is something that our shastras, our scriptures never like. And that's why it always tells us to spring us into action. And for doing all our journey of life also, we have to be in action. So the attitude of duty, niyatam kuru karmatvam, it is that I should do my duty in the best possible way, and not as a burden, with a joy, in all my roles and responsibilities that I have. And everyone needs to contribute. This is my part of my contribution in this universe. And God has given me this duty. As a Lord's servant, I must do the best that I can do. And no work is inferior, no work is superior. I should not compare with others my duty. And I should not do it with too much of ego or my pride, but with a lot of humility, thinking that this is, I am the instrument of doing this work as a nimitta matra bhava, and with the faith that I will be compensated adequately, rather than thinking about all the time the karma phala. The second duty that Lord Krishna shows is the yagna buddhi. Yagna artha karmano yatra lokoyam karma bandhanaha tadartham karma kaunteya mukta sangha samachara. So in the next four shlokas he talks about the yagna buddhi, and if we do any karma without the yagna buddhi, it will cause us bondage. So we should do according our karma yoga according to the attitude of, you know, yagna buddhi. Yagna buddhi means, in yagna what we do is we do an offering into the sacrificial fire. That is what it is done, ahuti, into the sacrificial fire. So it's basically you know, it's an Ishwara Arpana Bhav, whatever we are giving, it is for the larger good of others, not for just for ourselves. And then whatever we get, we accept it as a prasada buddhi. So that is a yagna buddhi. We should not be attached to the results. We should accept whatever is as a prasada. And samyak achara means we should do all our karmas in the best possible way, with the utmost dedication, with a samyak achara. So yagna buddhi can be, you know, individually, like when we are doing a worship or puja, that is also yagna buddhi. We do out of gratitude for the Lord. We think about the Lord in namasmarana. Whenever we do any action, we take the Lord's name and surrender this with the Ishwara Arpana Bhav, without any expectations or appreciation, and we do it for with joy in the best possible way. So on a samashti level, if you see, the universe entirely is a kind of a yagna which is happening, and everybody is contributing in their own way in this massive yagna. And I should also give my contribution in the place that where I am, my whatever is my duty. And this signifies a kind of sacrifice, to let go, to give, which is what the yagna teach us. And we should do it for the benefit of others, and in the process I also shall be benefited. And we must do it without an ego, that I am the karta, I am the doer. Saha yagna praja srushtva puro vacha prajapatihi anena prasavishyatvam eshavostvishtha kamaduka. So he says this yagna, Upteshi continues, is saying that yagna has been, it has been created by Brahmaji, has already said, and that you will all attain a lot of growth, and all your desired wishes, kama dukha gaya kitara, all your desired wishes will be fulfilled by this yagna. Devan bhavayatanena te deva bhavayantu vah parasparam bhavayantah shreya param vapsyatha. In this shloka he says that by the yagnas you please the devas, and those pleased devas will also make you happy, and with each other there is the opportunity to grow and you can achieve salvation. So that is what he says by yagna, that is how you can have upliftment. So yagnas can be of three types, and they can be adi bhautik, all in the sthula jagata that we see, everything is a yagna. Adi daivik, in the sukshma jagata, in the indriyas, the devas, devatas of the indriya, parigs, the manashakti, all these are energies. And in this sukshma jagata also, a lot of yagna, like our breathing, respiration, digestion system, a lot of yagnas are already going on. And the third is the adhyatma yagna, that is the third dimension, the spiritual dimension. So yagna teaches us to contribute, to give tyaga, ahuti, and this teaches us to make us more, giving rather than accepting, which creates a lot of problems. So it's a responsibility of every individual to contribute something in this universe according to the srushti cycle or the cosmic wheel that is going on. This yagna karma or yagna buddhi teaches us to think about others rather than just being selfish and think about our own self. We must try to give back to society, because society has done a lot for what we are today. And this does not create bondage by selfish actions, and these karmas are also done without pride, as an instrument or nimitta matra bhava. And I am fortunate that God has given me this opportunity, and ultimately the phala that I will get is my mind will become very calm, it will become happy, I will have a lot of knowledge, and it will also lead me to freedom. So these are all the benefits that will get if I keep doing this yagna karma buddhi yagna. Ishtan bhogan hi bo deva dasyante yagna bhavitaha tairdattana pradayaibhyo yo bhutestena eva saha. So here he says that the devatas who have been delighted by the yagna will give you the fruits that you desire. But these fruits you should share with others. If you don't share, you enjoy it without sharing with others, then that person is a thief. Stena eva saha. That person is like a thief. So here Lord tells us that whatever fruits we get from these yagna, whatever benefits, whatever we receive out of these from the devas, we should share it with others like a prasada buddhi. So that is what God does not like, selfish action. He likes us to think about others, to do our duties, our karma with a yagna karma buddhi. And one who just takes from this universe, does not give back, he says, is a thief. So with such selfish life, there is no upliftment, and we cannot achieve the ultimate potential that a human being can achieve. यज्ञशिष्ठाशिन संतो मुच्यन्ते सर्वकिल्बिषैः भुञ्जते ते त्वघं पापा ये पचन्त्यात्मकारणात्। सो दिस इज द थर्ड एटीट्यूड ऑफ प्रसाद बुद्धि। इट सेज व्हाटएवर यज्ञ कर्म फल प्रसाद व्हाटएवर दैट रिलीव्स अस विद ऑल अवर सिंस इफ यू एक्सेप्ट दिस एज अ प्रसाद बुद्धि। बट पीपल हु आर सेल्फिश हु कुक ओनली फॉर देयर ओन सेल्फ हु आर सेल्फ सेंटर्ड दे ओनली ईट सिंस सो दे हैव अ लॉट ऑफ पापा। Whereas most people who use the prasada buddhi, share the fruits with everyone, they are relieved of their sins. So prasada buddhi, essentially we see karma phala as a prasad which is accepted, it is shared, and we do while doing karma, we do it with the ishwararpana bhava. While receiving the results of the action, we have a prasada buddhi which helps us to relieve our raga dvesha. Rather than being selfish, we must be more large hearted, share and don't complain for our results. Do our karma with this attitude and this will help us to clean our mind, develop more peace and happiness. And then the fourth attitude shows the dharma buddhi, the srushti chakra in the 14th and the 15th shloka. Anna bhavanti bhutani parjanyat anna sambhavah yagnat bhavati parjanyo yagna karma samudbhavah. So it describes the srushti chakra. It says all the beings are born out of food, the food is born out of rains, the rain is occurs due to the yagna, and yagna is produced by the karma. It says in the next shloka, karma brahmodbhavam vidhi brahmakshara samudbhavam tasmat sarvagatam brahma nityam yagne pratishthitam. It says karma is prescribed in the Veda Shastra, and Veda Shastra is created by none other than the Paramatma. And therefore, Brahma is the foundation of everything which is all firmly rooted in Yagna. That it is what is the meaning of this shloka. So there is this Srushti Chakra through which, you know, Bhagavan has created the Veda Shastra, through which karmas are prescribed, and through karmas we do Yagnas, through Yagnas, you know, we please the Devtas, we have rain, through the rain we have the food, and through the food all the human beings and all the other beings are dharan jo karte hain unko, they are born out of these, because of even conception happens from the food, everything happens. So this is the meaning of this. So with this Srushti Chakra, it says humans have an independence to think, and they are tend to act in a selfish manner. They don't think of the long term consequences, and that's why they destroy the environment and create climate change. And so it's an important responsibility for us to maintain this harmony. Other animals have They behave with the natural instincts. However, humans have their own independent free will, and that's why they are likely to destroy this Srushti Chakra, and that's why they have to be given these lessons for the action, for the karma. Evam pravrutitam chakram nanuvartayati hayah aghayurindriya ramo mogham partha sajivati. So it says this Srushti Chakra, if somebody performs his duties in this chakra, he does not follow this Srushti Chakra, then his life is useless. So if somebody is, you know, Swachanda means he works according to only his likes, dislikes, does not think about the universe or other people, then his life is meaningless. He will not attain the human potential. His life is a waste. He says, Mogham Sajivati. So basically, from karma that we are doing, which is inspired by our desires, selfish desires, which benefits mostly us rather than others, and which is done with likes and dislikes, and these lead to bondage and may even lead to ruin and destruction. We have to migrate towards dharma karma. So dharma karma is more according to what is shastriya, what is kartavya, what is our, you know, prescribed duties, which are selfless, which are for the benefit of not just myself but others at large, and it are not done with raga dvesha, leads to freedom and leads to upliftment in our journey of life. So the third session of Karma Yoga, Lord Krishna says, till what time do we have to continue doing this karma? And when does this Karma Yoga end? So he talks about the Vinana part in this third session. It says, but when a person talks about three things, person becomes Atmarati, Atmatruptaha, Atmasantushtaha. Then that person, Tasya Karyam Na Vidyate, for that person there is no karma. So Atmarati means that person can enjoy in his own, having physical happiness in his own self. Ignorant or the Ajnani needs to be dependent on the physical bodies of his or others for his own physical happiness. Whereas a Jnani does not have to depend on this. A Jnani is trupti, fulfillment is by desires from outside. Whereas Jnani's fulfillment is also within himself. Atma trupta, his fulfillment is inside because he feels completely paripurna or fulfilled. And tushti, satisfaction for a Jnani is also outside, whereas for a Jnani it is inside. So Jnani is dependent for most of his, all of his life's activities, whereas Jnani is completely free, is swadhin, whereas ignorant Ajnani is paradhin. And that's why the Ajnani or the unwise person has to live in the past or in the future to make him for being happy, whereas Jnani lives in the present because he's in the joy, he's having the bliss, and this is because of it, he lives in the presence. Naiva tasya krute nartho na krute neha kashchana na chasya sarva bhuteshu kashchidartha prapashrayah. So wise does not have any motive in action and in inaction. He may do work, he may be in action or he may be in inaction, but he does not have any selfish motive to acquire or to unacquire anything. Tasmat asakta satatam karyam karma samachara asakto yacharan karma paramapnoti purushah. That's why Lord Krishna says that you do your karma yoga with the best possible way, do your kartavya duty, your prescribed duties, and be asakta, don't have attachment to the results of the action. And with this, if you keep doing this, you will achieve the highest goal of life, param goal. Param goal is to have oneness with the Paramatma, moksha, and you will achieve this goal. So Arjuna must have thought, how is it possible that just by doing these duties without likes, dislikes, and with understanding that all duties are the same, how can I achieve the param apnoti? And Lord says that you have to be asakta, and asakti, where attachment needs to be done, where not to be done, is also to be understood. So karma is the nature of our being, so we have to do karma, we have to have our asakti, meaning we have to be involved in karma, not in karma tyaga. Karma tyaga is not something that scriptures tell us to do, but where tyaga is needed are two things. One is karma phala tyaga. So karma phala, we don't have to think about it, whatever is there we have to accept. And kartrutva is where we have to do tyaga, means the doership feeling, kartrutva also we have to let go or we have to leave. So we need to understand where we need, what we need to do and where we need to be asakta or unattached. Karmanaiva hi sansiddhim astita janakadayah lokasangrahamevapi sampashyan kartum arhasi. So Arjuna must have thought that how by doing just karma I can achieve moksha or liberation, and here Lord Krishna gives him an example of King Janaka, who was within all his worldly pleasures and his gregarious kingdom, but he was still anasakta, he was asakta, he was agnani. So he achieved his final goal of life by just working for the welfare of the people at large, and that's what Lord Krishna tells him, that even being in the karma you can achieve your ultimate goal of life. Yadhyadacharati shveshtah tattadevitaro janah sayat pramanam kurute lokastadanuvartate. So he says great people have great responsibility because the way they work, all the other people follow them. So people, it is known that, you know, people try to follow or imitate others. It is also called herd mentality, and that's why he says all the human beings follow the same behavior, and that's why it is a great responsibility of successful or great people that they must do actions with proper understanding and with the proper, because they form examples for others. And here, how this dharma can be decided can be a question. And dharma generally is decided by our scriptures, or hierarchy is the way the shastra, all the shruti is, of course, they are not much available to general people at large. Smriti shastra, the Purana, Ityasa shastra, Mahabharata, Ramayana, Bhagavad Gita, all these, but also they are limited availability. Whereas Sat Purusha Acharana, that is available to many people. We can see how Sat Purusha or good, great men, Mahapurusha, they live their life. With this, we can learn a lot. Sometimes even an inner voice of our conscience, but this is only for a person who is rooted in Dharma. For him, the inner voice will be important. For a person who is always in Adharma, His inner voice is already smothered by his attitudes and his karma. Name parthasti kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana
नान वाप्तम वाप्तव्यम वर्त एव च कर्मणि.
So Krishna gives his own example and shows his lordship. He says, I do not have any duty to perform, but even I don't have to acquire anything in this world, neither I have to unacquire or give away anything on this world, but still I am in action. Lord Krishna has done so many duties in Mahabharata, if you see, without being attached, and that's why his life itself is a lesson, and that's what he's talking in this shloka.
Yadi yaham na varteyam jatu karmanya tandritaha mama varpanu vartante manushyah partha sarvashah.
He says, if I don't perform my actions with awareness, atandritaha, then all the human beings also will follow the same path, and that's why I have to do my prescribed duties with lot of awareness, atandritaha. So it is a message to us to do all our actions with lot of awareness, with proper planning before we start the actions. Without being lazy, we must try and attain our goal, and whatever is worth doing well, and we should do every work in the best possible manner.
Utside yurive loka na kuryam karma chedaham sankarasya cha kartasyam upahanya mimah prajaha.
So Krishna says, if I don't do my prescribed duties, my actions, if I remain in inaction, then it will destroy the social order, it will destroy the universal harmony, and it will make people sankarasya. That is, the mixed race will be created, and ultimately there will be destruction of the entire human race.
Saptah karmanya vidvanso yatha kurvanti bharata kuryan vidvans tatha saptah jikirshu loka sangraham.
So in this shloka he says that from outside you may not be able to distinguish between whether this person is a wise person, a jnani, or an unwise person who is ignorant, because both of them should do the karma with the same way, like with the same involvement, with the same attachment to the karma, and this should be, the wise person will do it for the betterment of all the human beings at large. By being asanga, he is also free from attachment, though he is full of love, but he is free from attachment. It is possible to remain completely full of love but still free of attachments, and he does not do out of duty but for the welfare of the people at large, and that's why he is in samatva, and that's why he is able to remain tatastha, upright, and that's why he remains always more composed or swastha, and he maintains the harmony of the universe at large. So this is what the jnani purush does.
Na buddhi bhedam janayet ajnanam karma sanginam joshayet sarva karmani vidvan yukta samacharan.
Here he says that the wise person should not shatter the faith of the other people who are already involved in action, or the ignorant people, and everybody should try to inspire others who are into action. So basically we should not shatter the faith and inspire other people. So in the fourth session of Karma Yoga, 27th shloka, Lord Krishna says,
Prakrute kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashah ahankara vimudhatma kartahamiti manyate.
So here he says, Aviveki Purush, how he lives in this world. He says, all the actions are performed by the three gunas of nature, but the person who is identifies himself with this body, mind and self complex, the sense complex, that the Karya Karan Sangata, believes that I am the doer. So that's how he believes. Whereas the Tattva Vittu, so what the Aviveki Purush believes, that I am the Karta, I am the Aham Karta, Aham Bhokta, whatever are the fruits, I am the, and that's how this feeling causes a bondage of the Sansara Bandhana, because he has Ahankar, identification with his own form, his own name and his limited body. Whereas a person who has a Shuddha Aham, a pure I, that is identified with the omnipresent I, the Shuddha Tattva, then he is unlimited, he is not bound to this self, that Aham is unlimited. So that is the person who is a Tattva Vittu, or who knows this Tattva.
Tattva Vittu Mahabaho Guna Karma Vibhagayoho Guna Guneshu Vartanta Iti Matvana Sajjate.
So the wise person, a learned person, how he understands, what he believes. He believes that he is a person, Tattva Vitta, who knows this Tattva, which is one eternal, universal, self that is present in this world, which is, in our Shastras, is called as Atma or Brahma, or Paramatma, you may call it by Chaitanya, it could be any names could be given, but this oneness which is there in this universe and everything else which is all derived from the Prakriti, the gunas of the Prakriti, the divisions of the guna karma are all in the Prakriti, and he understands that his karma is done between the gunas and the gunas. So it is the guna that operate in the guna, and that's why he does not get attached to these gunas. So that is the understanding of this person. So his drashti is ignorant person, aviveki person, with the ahankara, he thinks I am the doer, I am the enjoyer. But the tattvavit gnani, with his aikya gnan, with his vivek, he understands that I am the observer and all this karma is happening in this guna, gunashu vartanta, it is between the guna and the guna. Prakrute gune sambhudhaha sajjante guna karmasu tana kratsna vidho mandan kratsna vinna vichalaye. So he says here that we should not disturb the unwise people who are in their actions, because they are all deluded, mohit, in the gunas of the nature. They are aviveki purusha, they get attached to all the gunas, karmas, and akritsnavit, a person who has a complete knowledge should not disturb the akritsnavit. Akritsnavit is a person who does not have a full knowledge, is a agnani, unwise person according to our shastras, who thinks the jagat is the most important thing and this is the truth, it will give me happiness, and he keeps on changing, wants to change the people and the circumstances in this world. Whereas for Ishwara, he feels that he is far away somewhere in the heaven or maybe the temple, and he fears the God and he transacts with the God. God, I'll do this to you, prayers, please give me something. And he feels that God is the cause for his or her miseries. And for the Jiva, for himself as an individual, he thinks I'm the doer, I'm the enjoyer, I'm the body, I'm happy, I'm sad, I have ups and downs, complaints, fears, feels incomplete, lot of desires, always wants more and more and more. So he sees all the Bheda Buddhi, all the differences in all the three. Whereas a Krishnavit, the Gnani, sees everything as one. He has Abheda Buddhi. Jagata does not give so much importance to this world, to these people, relationships. He does not want to change anyone. He sees this world like a drama and he sees God everywhere in this world. Ishwara, he knows that this is a pervading force, that energy which is the part of his own self and which is not unseparated. There is aikya in this force and he has no fear from God. And he knows that two individual, as an individual, my essence as a Jiva is the same as the essence of the Shiva. And that's why he has no complaints, no fears. He feels complete, he feels unlimited. There is a complete freedom and he works out of joy. So he sees Abheda Buddhi, oneness in all the three. So that is the difference between the Akritsnavit and the Kritsnavit or a Jnani.
Mahi Sarvani Karmani Sanyasyadhyatma Chetasa Nirashir Nirmamo Bhutva Yudhyasva Vigatajvaraha.
So here Lord Krishna shows the path of Nishkam Karma Yoga to all of us seekers and says, you surrender all your actions to me, Mahi Sarvani Karmani Sanyasya and Adhyatma Chetasa. Do your journey with a spiritual mind. And he says three things: Nirashi Bhutva, let go of the results of the action; Nirmamo, be unattached to the results; and Yudhyasva Vigata Jwara, do your duties without any tapa, santapa or anger or miseries. So surrender to the God is one of the important parts of path of Karma Yoga. Ishwarapan Bhav, Nimitta Bhav, we should take away, which will help us to take away the pride, ego of from our actions and the attachment from the results. And this is comes with the attitude of gratitude, krutagnata to the Lord for whatever he is doing, with ego surrender, which is the final surrender, which is the most important thing to surrender, to become egoless, and which helps us to clean up our minds of impurities and shuddhi. Adhyatma Chetasa is a God consciousness, that we keep God in front of us all the time when we are doing actions, and the attitude that whatever happens is due to God, it all belongs to God, everything, he is the boss, he manages everything, he has given me these duties and I must do my duty in the best possible way, and he has developed or designed or he has created these laws of karma, karma phala, through which whatever I do, I'll be reciprocated appropriately. This karma, karma phala are a very fair and a just laws. Nirashi means we should not have any expectations, because this is the expectations are the root cause of all the miseries. But we should do every karma in the best possible way without thinking of the results all the time. But our focus must be on the karma, and instead of, we should think of the God, Namasmarana, while we do karma, so that we do Ishwara Arpana Buddhi, and results of the action are determined by several aspects, finally by God. Nirmamo means whenever there is the results, we should accept it as a prasada buddhi. And Vigata Jwara means without any anger or frustration, we should do all our duties with complete joy, each moment in joy, not as a burden with complaints. And in this drama of life, we should do our roles in the best possible way. Eventually, it will help to modulate and control my mind and purify my mind.
Ye me matamidam nityam anutishthanti manavaha shraddha vanto nasuyanto chante tepi karma bihi.
So he says, whatever this path that I have shown, this karma yoga path and all the attitudes and all the bhavana, if you do it with faith and without finding faults, anasuya, then you will be liberated from this karma. Through karma yoga, of course, we must remember that we can only have shuddhi. It is only with gnan we can have mukti. So this is the cycle we always should remember. But this is what Lord says, that in the next shloka he says,
ye tve tadabhyasuyanto nanutishthanti me matam sarva gnana vimudhasthan vidhinashtana chetasah.
He says, one who does not follow the path that I have shown, keeps blaming asuya, and he does not follow this path, he will be filled with all the moha, delusions, he will become vimuda, and he will be ruined. He is nashtana chetasah, because he will not be able to achieve the ultimate goal of his life.
Sadrasham cheshtate swasyaha prakruter gnana vanapi prakrutim yanti bhutani nigraha kim karishyati.
This says everybody behaves according to their nature, according to their personality. All actions are done based on our nature and personality. So how can I change my personality or my nature? That is the question that Lord himself asked. It's probably a question of the seeker, that, you know, if everything is because of my personality, how can I change this? So prakriti or the nature is our default settings, but this Lord Krishna tells us that we can change this, though it takes time, efforts. But seeker is the person who wants a change in himself, does not want the change outside in the others. And this is all because of our innate habits, and a bit we can keep changing them and it can finally go away. But we should not say that it is my nature, I cannot change, because it is my nature, I can change. And humans have been bestowed with this power to change one our own self. So where do we need to change and what do we need to change? That is what is a beautiful shloka that Lord Krishna tells us, and where all the problems are hidden and how he is coming to the, you know, the nail of the problem, coming to the root cause.
Indriyasya arthe ragatveshau vyavasthitau tayor navashama gacche tau yasya paripanthinau.
So here is where I need to work. He says, in the sense organs and the objects thereof, indriyasya arthe raga dvesha vyavasthitau, they are firmly rooted. These raga dvesha don't get under their spell or their influence, they are very powerful. Tayorna vashamagache, he says, tau yasya paripantino, they are the biggest obstacles, the biggest enemies in the path of a spiritual aspirant. So clearly Lord Krishna mentions that raga dvesha are our main enemies. Our enemies are not outside, our enemies are inside, in our mind. They are sitting and creating the havoc and creating the unrest in our mind. So what are these raga dvesha? They are the that makes our nature, that determines our action and our behavior. Through these raga dvesha, we believe that, we feel that it is natural due to unawareness, but the way they work is that whenever I do some karma and I have some pleasure, I get a raga with this, and this impels me or attracts me to that and keeps me doing that into action. Whereas when I get some pain or a dvesha, then I get a repulsion from that work and I don't want to again go and, you know, eat that food or meet that person or get into that relationship. So that is a dvesha bhavana. And with this can happen with a lot of persons, objects, a lot of things like praise, expectation, the attitude, the appreciation, food, and a lot of other senses that we experience in this world. So basically these are all experiences that creates this kind of our habits. And tayorna vashamagachet means this is the area where we have to work. This is our area of free will. This is not the destiny. And we must know, keep our goals in our mind, use intellect and see the other side, the pratipaksha bhavana, see the long-term goals, and that's how we should pravrutta ourselves into action. So our daily introspection is also a very, very effective tool, that where our raga, dvesha, what is that in the day, what we have done, whether we have done it according to our free independent will or we have been थ्रू दिस राग द्वेष वी हैव बीन प्रवृत्त
श्रेयान स्वधर्मो विगुणः परधर्मात् स्वनुष्ठितात् स्वधर्मे निदनम् श्रेयः परधर्मो भयावहः.
So here Lord Krishna talks about swadharma, my duty. My dharma is my duty, which is the best, which is better than anybody else's dharma. We have an attitude of comparing ourselves with others, but he says here that swadharme nidanam shreya, the death is better than following others' duty. We should all follow our own duty, and it is dangerous to follow others' duty. Paradharmo bhayavaha. So swadharma, in the ancient times it was on the varnashrama vyavastha. Today it is my duty in my each role of our life, which is beneficial to me and to others. If you take the meaning of swa, means my own self, which is my atma swarupa, which is sat, chit and ananda. So sat is the existence, and so my duty is to live happily, healthily, and to let others live happily and healthily. Chit is the knowledge part, and here I must learn to make all my efforts to learn and help others to learn and manage my emotions. And ananda means I should be happy and keep others happy. Don't complain, be peaceful, have a quiet mind and remain in bliss. So that is what it means, that this is my swadharma.
Arjuna uvacha athakena prayuktoyam papam charati purushah anichchannapi varshneya baladiva niyojitah.
So in this, Arjuna asks a question, that what it is that forces a person to do these sinful activities against his own wish. By force he is drawn into or pushed into committing some kind of a sin. And this is our common experience. Even if we don't want to do a particular thing, we are forced to do that because of our innate raga dvesha. And he says, what is it that forces us to do this sinful activity? To which Lord Shri Krishna answers,
काम एष क्रोध एष रजोगुण समुद्भवः महाशनो महापाप्मा विद्येन मिह वैरिणम्.
So it says two things, काम and क्रोध. Both of these, this desire, this काम and this क्रोध, the anger which arise out of rajoguna, rajas guna, they are the main problems. They are both your enemies, because they are, this karma is not just sexual attractions, but all types of desires arise out of the thoughts, sankalpa, and gives me this shobna dhyasa, that illusion that this is good for me, it will give me happiness. And it arises because of the incompleteness in my mind, which is aparipurnata, is because of the ajnana. And it starts with a thought, but then becomes a desire, then becomes a more intense desire. Then I want this object or this person very badly, and I can't stay without it. And then it engulfs me completely without thinking. I get attached and makes me dependent on other people for my own happiness. So this makes me kind of a paradhina. Similarly, krodh also is engulfs the happiness, hides happiness. It gives pain. It's like a fire, gives pain to the person who does the krodh, as well as on the person to whom this krodh or anger is done. And when does it happen? When the desires don't get fulfilled, anger comes, and it, when it is expressed, it burns not only person but the others. And when it is suppressed, it then comes out as a violence, and it forces us to do whatever what we probably never would want to do, makes us blind, and that's why it is the biggest enemy for us. So raga dvesha are the root cause, the work most mysteriously how in the root of the karma and the krodha. So raga dvesha inspires us to do these sins, and raga leads to karma, makes us feel incomplete, and dvesha leads to krodha, expressed as anger. And so to sublimate or to control our kamna, our desires, we need to use our understanding, our buddhi shakti, our vivek shakti, vichar shakti, and we should try to discriminate what are essential desires, and we should do what are non-essential desires. We should think further whether this is attuned to my goals in life, whether it will fulfill my goal, whether this is the need that I need right now or I can do it later on. And be aware in the thought stage before the strong desire starts. And even if all desires are fulfilled, my experience shows, tells me that more and more desires will spring up, and it will not keep me peaceful. It will just help me, keep me running around in this world without developing or having any peace of mind. And that's why the place where I'll get the peace is to surrender to the Lord. With His grace, I'll get this peace of mind. Krodha. We must accept krodha as a vice or an enemy. We should not rationalize, we should not justify, that krodha is good, anger is good because people listen to me. We must have a firm resolve, drad nishchay, that we want to get rid of anger. It is an obstacle in my path, and we must think of the loss because of the anger. There is no gain whatsoever, even in the long run, by having anger. So we be aware in the early stages, because krodha gives us the, you know, the warning. Some temporary solutions can be there, but in the long run, we have to have a many good attitudes with understanding. Though it is difficult because it has been with us since ages, it is not impossible to get rid of anger.
धूमे नाव्रियते वन्हि यथा दर्शो मलेन च यथोल्बेनावृतो गर्भः तथा तेन दमावृतम्.
So in this shloka, Lord Krishna says that Atmajnan is concealed by all these desires, and these desires are born out of Ajnana, and that's how Ajnana, the ignorance, conceals Atmajnana. And he gives three examples. Yatha dhumena vanhi, as the smoke conceals the fire, just like the dirt conceals the mirror, the image in the mirror, and just as the womb envelops and conceals the fetus, similarly all these desires, they conceal the Atmajnana, self-knowledge. So here, this can be likened to the three types of desires: the sattvic desire, that is the desire for good things, worldly, or it could be in a spiritual quest; the rajasic desires, which arise out of, you know, our desire to do a lot of activities and work to earn a lot of things that will keep us in this worldly, you know, pleasure, give us these worldly pleasures; and the tamasic desires, which I want to be happy at others' cost also sometimes. And these, all these three examples can be linked to these three types of desires. So ultimately, my spiritual journey should be that my tamasic desires should be converted into rajasic desires. Rajasic desires, when we do the work, we should do it with a sattvic bhavana for the helping others at large. And finally, on a spiritual knowledge, we have to even leave this sattvic desire and become nistray gunyo bhava arjuna. That means we have to go for the atmajnana, to leave all the desires. In the Sita Pragna first shloka, Lord Krishna says, prajahati yada kaman sarvan partham anugatam. All the desires have to be left to become, ultimately to become Sita Pragna.
Avruttam jnana metena jnanino nitya vairina kama rupena kaunteya dushpurena nalena cha.
So here he says that this true knowledge remains concealed because of these desires, and these desires are never satisfied. These are like dushpurena, they are like fire, they are analena, and they know that they are your permanent enemies. And when this question must have come to the mind of Arjuna, that if I have to control these desires, I must know where they live, what is their home. And the next shloka, Lord Krishna tells him that know that their home is
Indriyani mano buddhihi asya adhishtana muchyate etair vimoha yatyesha jnanamavrutya dehinam.
He says Indriya, mana and buddhi, which these three, which are part of our sukshma sharira, are the place where these desires live. They don't live in the stula sharira, our body. They don't live in the atma swarupa, which is completely akarta, it is asanga, it has no desires. But they live in the sukshma sharira, and from there they delude the mind, they create this moha, they conceal the knowledge of the jiva from these areas. So let us see how the kama can remain in the indriya. So indriya, basically we know that these five jnana indriyas, they you know, when we see something or hear something, the desires arise. But sometimes when we are sitting quietly also, in the mana these desires arise, even when the indriyas are not active. And in the buddhis, because of a lot of thoughts, the desires arise. So these are the three areas where our desires come. And modulation of these three, or disciplining of the indriya, mana and buddhi, is the main part of the adhyatma sadhana, or the spiritual practices, where we have to use our thinking, our discrimination, our intellect to scrutinize all desires, to do introspection, and gradually daily we'll have progress. But we have to continue this activity every day for the lifetime. And the fruit that we get is to our mind will become more quiet, more still, more peaceful. And we must not just learn these attitudes, but also try to put them into our practice in life, so that we can get this benefit during our lifetime.
Tasmat vamindriyanyatau niyamya bharatarshabha papmanam prajahi yenam jnana vijnana nashanam.
So he says you start with the Indriya Sanyama, that is the first step of the spiritual journey, and these are the desires are the one that push us to commit the sins, and it destroys our wisdom, our jnana and vijnana, the knowledge, the outer knowledge that we have, the vijnana, knowledge of the realities of the world. And you have to control these desires, you have to leave them. Prajahi means you have to burn, you have to let go all these desires. So Adhyatma Yatra is a yatra which is an inner yatra. It starts with Indriya Sanyama, Dharma Palana. Then we have to get our Raga Dvesha, and then with the understanding, with Vichar Shakti, we have to control and modulate our Indriya, Mana and Buddhi, and finally surrender to God and channelize all our energies to the Lord. So Indriya Sanyam can be, lots of spiritual practices are all basically centered around Indriya Sanyama, Tapa, Shaucha, Vidhi, Swadhyaya, Santosha, Ishwara, Ishwara Pranidhan. All these activities are, they help us to create our Manas Niyamana and Indriya Sanyamana. So we have to do these practices regularly to discipline our mind, our intellect, by being aware of lot of things. And then the finally two shlokas, Lord tells us what is the hierarchy and how do we need to work. He has shown us all the problems, now he tells us the solution, how we need to work. So he says, Indriyani paranyahuhu indriyepya param manaha manasastu para buddhihi yo buddhe paratastu saha. So he gives here an hierarchy that the senses of the indriya are superior, para, than the objects of the body. He says, mind is above the senses, indriya, and the intellect, buddhi, is even para to the mana, above the mind, and even above the mind or above the buddhi or the intellect is the consciousness, which is the atma, which is the knower of all. And finally he says, evam buddhe param buddhva sanstabhyatmanam atmana jahi shatrum mahabaho. Kamarupam durasadam. Finally he says, with acquiring this self-knowledge, Atma-jnana, you can perish your ignorance with this understanding of the Atma, and then controlling the mind and the intellect with the buddhi, we can conquer our enemies, Kamarupam, and all these desires which can let go with this understanding. So in the spiritual practice, the control hierarchy is that the, you know, Indriya is superior to the Vishaya, the Mana is superior to the Indriya, Buddhi is superior to the Mana, and Atma is the superior of all, the Shrestha of all. Whereas in meditation, when we start the control, we start from the Vishaya, go towards the Indriya, Mana, Buddhi, and then we go to the Atma. So that is, this is the way we have to progress. So with this, we come to the end of this third Adhyaya, that is the Karma Yoga. Om Tat Sat Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gitasu Upanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Shri Krishna Arjuna Samvade Karma Yogo Nama Tritiyodhyayah Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Vraja Aham Tva Sarva Papebhyo Moksha Ishyami Mashuchaha. So finally, just a last summary of the attitudes of karma, karma yoga, and this third adhyaya, both the subjects of karma and jnana represented by Shri Krishna. And the attitudes which have been shown here again are Ishwara Arpana Bhava, surrender to the Lord, Ishwara Prasannata, to please the Lord, we should do all of our karma as if it is the Lord's order, and with myself as an instrument, that I am the instrument in this journey and should do all my karma as my duty, as my all the different roles in life, and whenever there is a result of the of my karma that I get, I must share it with, I must accept it unconditionally and accept it as a prasada buddhi and share with everyone. So with this we come to the end of this session. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnah Purnam Gachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.